Can I, first of all, welcome you to Glasgow Cathedral. It's good to see you here. It's good to see you here, but I'm sad to see you here. Because who would really want to be here for a service like this? Yes, it's a service of celebration and thanksgiving, but a service where we acknowledge the loss and the absence and the silence of a voice that we once heard, we once knew, we once loved, we once enjoyed. But today is about focusing on the good stuff. It's about looking at those aspects in life that will in some ways fill and enhance our life here on in. As a Christian minister, I don't promise pie in the sky when we die, but what I do try to do is offer the consolation of the Christian faith. So when it says things like the souls of the righteous, I'm often relieved it doesn't say the perfect because I'm not claiming perfection, but the souls of the righteous, those who strive to walk the right path in life, the souls of the righteous are in the hands of God. When you come here today thinking about Walter, I'm sure that, well, when someone we know and we loved dies, we often have a sense in which we lose a bit of our past. Some of the things that we've shared and we've enjoyed, we feel as though we lose them because we can't talk about them in the way we once did. But I think with Walter's passing, there's also a sense in which we feel as though we lose a bit of our future. It won't be the same here on in. But we come here to celebrate and give thanks for the good times. This is the People's Cathedral. And in a sense, we are the people today who have gathered in this place to celebrate a life well lived and a life that we want together to give thanks for and to celebrate. Jesus said, I am the resurrection and I am the life. If a person has faith in me, even though they die, they shall have life eternal. You come here not to spectate, but to participate. And therefore, I invite you with me to turn to the order of service that you have at hand. Having looked at the cover photograph, which I'm sure must bring comfort and joy, we turn to our opening hymn, the 23rd Psalm, The Lord is my shepherd, I'll not want. After the introduction, we will stand to sing. Please be seated. Let us come to God and speak to God. Let us pray. Living God, we come here today with our memories, our rich memories of Walter, what he was and what he will remain. There's a deep sadness, and that his company will no longer be enjoyed, his laughter no longer heard, his smile or his look no longer seen in the way that it once was. But we come here today not to churn over, not to revisit regrets or remorse. We're not here today to focus on the might-have-beens, the could-have-beens, or the should-have-beens. We're here to focus on what has been and what we want to celebrate. We recognise that there is legacy and there is inheritance. And therefore, that must sit at the heart of what we do in this time together. So do not allow our wordiness to get in the way of our emotions and our response to a good life and a life well lived. Living God, we know the rich tapestry of our life and of our living. We recognise those that we give life to and who therefore become the custodians of what it is we leave with them. Help us therefore today, when we think about Walter, what he was and what he will remain, to forever keep those good times alive. But give us a sense in which today is not about endings. Today, in many ways, is about a continued journey. Because eternity is not something in the future, not something that starts at some time beyond now. Eternity starts right here, right now. And we have that sense in which for him it has already begun. There is no more suffering or pain. Even death itself lies behind him. Your work in him is now complete. And in this service, we seek an opportunity to find consolation, to find hope, to find reassurance in what we share together. So be with us, and may we embrace the whole of a man, recognizing that when mighty trees and oaks fall, the earth is shaken. And may we today know the tremor of that fall among us. For this we ask in Jesus' name, present with us here. Amen.
Good afternoon. First and foremost, I'd like to take this opportunity to thank everyone here today for attending my dad's memorial service. I'd also like to thank people from home and abroad who have sent kind messages of support and flowers to my mum and her family in recent weeks, including the football fans, managers, players, clubs and associations who have got in touch at this difficult time or who have paid tribute to my dad in some way. It's so important I extend my gratitude to my dad's doctor, Paul Jackson, and all the tremendous NHS staff and nurses who helped him through his three-year battle with cancer. Finally, this afternoon's service would not have been possible without the board and staff at Rangers. The club's support to our family since Dad's passing has been incredible. I also want to thank Reverend Mark Johnson and Reverend Stuart McQuarrie and Ian Miller to my right for their efforts to make today a very special occasion. The fact we are saying a final farewell to my dad in the beautiful and historic Glasgow Cathedral, the city's oldest building, says so much about the incredible life he enjoyed and what he achieved. A boy from the village of Carmyle in the East End, who went to Ibrox with his dad and granddad to watch Rangers play in the 50s and 60s, he could never have dreamt back then that he would go on to manage that club twice, winning 21 trophies, and also take charge of the Scotland national team. But that's what happened. He lived the dream. Away from football, he was a devoted husband of over 50 years, an amazing dad and father-in-law, and latterly, he was so proud to be a granddad to my daughter Jessica and twins Adam and Jack, and my brother's four sons, Kean, Zach, Tom, and Matthew. Being the only granddaughter, Jessica and her papa had a very special bond, but having six grandsons meant that even after he retired, Dad's life continued to revolve around football, which was great for him, but probably quite frustrating for my mum. One of my abiding memories of Dad will be of him sitting in his chair at home, trying to peacefully watch a game on TV with his grandsons circled around him, bombarding him with football questions for the full 90 minutes. At half-time, he would get dragged off his seat to go on imaginary goals as the boys fired shots at him, Dad doing everything he could to stop my mum's vases or the window blinds being smashed to smithereens. Dad loved it, of course, although I'm sure there were times he thought that retiring in 2011 was a mistake, as being a football manager was probably easier and less stressful than the duties as a doting grandparent. Towards the end of his life, one of the saddest and probably one of the most heartbreaking aspects of his illness was the fact that he could no longer do the things he enjoyed the most, like simply going out for lunch and catching up with his friends, taking Jessica shopping or to concerts, or going to watch his grandsons play rugby or football, which I know he loved and he looked forward to every weekend. I can remember one game in particular my twins played in. Their team was winning 4-0 at half-time, and the opposition came back to make it 4-3 before the final whistle, which was agitating my dad in the second half. On the way home in the car, Dad gave his post-match assessment, as he normally did. Great result today, boys, he said, but you maybe could have worked a bit harder in the second half, and the team could have kept its shape and kept the ball a bit better. My boys were only 6 years old and playing five-a-side, so they found out pretty quickly it would be hard to impress their papa. In many ways, my dad did have two sides to him. He was a family man first and foremost, and a great one at that, but he also had a tough streak to him. And so many former players and newspaper reporters will talk about the famous Walter Stair if they stepped out of line. That part of his personality probably came from the fact he expected high standards, and he's tried to project those standards on a daily basis in the way he presented himself. His car was always immaculately clean, his brown brogues always well polished, and his walk-in wardrobe at home was a sight to behold, with his suits and jackets flowing perfectly from blue to grey to black before he came to the navy Walter cardigans at the end, and he had a lot of them. When we were younger, Stephen and I would often move his navy suits just into the middle of the grey section just to wind them up, which I'm sure annoyed him and brought a smile to his face in equal measure. In the last few weeks of his life, I had several chats with my dad about what he achieved in his football career. And one thing he said that stuck with me was, I was lucky to work with so many great people. In many ways, that was Dad. While I'm sure he could be demanding and a tough character in the dressing room when required, he was, above everything else, a people person. If a family member, a player, a friend or another coach or manager asked for help or advice, you'd give it without hesitation or need of anything in return. So many players who worked under Dad talk about his man management skills being one of his attributes. And there was one occasion in particular when our family got to see his compassionate and caring side when it came to his squad at Rangers. 25 years ago on Christmas Day in the mid-90s, Dad found out that one of his players was alone in a Loch Lomond lodge as there was a game on Boxing Day. To my mum's surprise, Dad decided to invite the player to her house for dinner. It was, of course, the one and only Paul Gascoigne. As this was a time before 7 grandkids, Christmas was a far less chaotic occasion than it is these days, but having Gazza present ensured it was unforgettable. You can picture the scene, sitting around the table with my mum and dad, me and my brother Stephen, my dad's sister Liz, my grandpa Jack, and then Gazza. I remember every now and again looking at Stephen, both of us baffled as to how one of the world's most famous footballers ended up at our table wearing a Christmas party hat and pulling crackers with my grandpa, who couldn't hear or understand the word Gazza was saying. I've already mentioned the famous Walter Stair, but you can imagine his face when later that day Gazza disappeared for 10 minutes and we looked out the living room window, there he was, singing and dancing in the next door neighbour's conservatory. It was a crazy Christmas, but on that afternoon and evening we got to see the special relationship Dad had with Paul, the kind of relationship I know he had with so many of his players and the people he worked with, whether that be Dundee United, Dumbarton, Rangers, Everton, Manchester United or Scotland. But of course, there was so much more to my dad than being a football coach and manager. He was a wonderful person. He was humble and modest and also funny, quick-witted and great company. As I've already touched on, he loved nothing more than spending time with friends and family. And it goes without saying that for Stephen and I, he was an incredible dad, someone we could and always will look up to with so much pride and admiration. Without mentioning one of the Tina Turner's most famous songs, to us, Walter Ferguson Smith was undoubtedly the best. And although we have so many amazing memories from his time with us, we will miss him every day. Thank you.
Good afternoon, everyone. I'm Ian Smith from Kirkmile. And what a magnificent setting this is. It's my great honour and privilege to recognise Walter's impact as an older brother to Elizabeth and I within the greater context of his extraordinary life. Walter's background has been well documented in various articles and books. We were raised in a working class family in Carmyle, a small village that lies to the east end of Glasgow. Our parents, Jack and Betty Smith, rented a council house and provided a warm and stable environment for our childhood. Our grandfather, Jock Rogerson, who lived with us in Carmyle, was a fervent Rangers supporter and brought us into the Rangers fold. He was a jovial man and dubbed Walter the Quiet Man, and I was nicknamed Kitch after Don Kitchenbrand. I wish old Jock could have lived to see the legendary success of his grandson at the club he loved. Walter met Ethel at an early age as the daughter of George and Jean Wilson, our parents, best friends and neighbours. So Ethel was like a big sister to Elizabeth and I. As we all know now, Ethel became Walter's wife, partner and soulmate for the past 50 years. What a love story. During their teenage courting years, I earned some pocket money by making myself scarce when our parents were out on a Saturday night. You can call it bribery. I prefer to see it as capitalism at work. He was the eldest son, and as such became the leader of the family siblings in the eyes of our father. He took on that responsibility as a blessing rather than a curse. As our parents aged, Walter became the rock of our extended families that grew with sons, daughters, and grandchildren. Elizabeth and I were so fortunate to have someone who shared his time, wisdom, and successes with all of us. Walter's feats as a player and a manager will be recorded in history as wins and losses, championships and cups, but his real legacy is his children, Neil and Stephen, and grandchildren that are present here today. This was Walter and Ethel's foremost purpose in life, and clearly their commitment proved successful. They are rightly proud of the two boys and their families. Walter told Neil and Stephen recently that he cannot recall us ever having quarreled. I can remember one occasion. Walter was probably around 17 and I was 12. We had set up a miniature snooker table in the living room one Sunday morning, and of course, it became competitive. Well, I am winning, and as you can believe, I was crowing about it. When in a blur, I'm pinned against the wall by Walter with a snooker cue across my chest. I learned that day not to poke the bear. I only remember seeing Walter teary-eyed once when Ann and I got dropped off at the airport for our move to Atlanta in 1981. It did not take him long to recover, and for the next 40 years, he repeatedly claimed that I nicked his favorite albums. As a big fan of Pink Floyd and other rock bands, I ask you, why would I steal LPs of Barry Manilow? On reading all the tributes to Walter this past few weeks, there are many references to his character. Intelligence, courage, dignity, honesty, and loyalty, and many more. I think his greatest strength was judgment. Like all great leaders, he had the ability to decisively assess situations and walk that line between right or wrong, action or inaction, friend or gaffer. Many of us golf partners knew he was not above a bit of gamesmanship, however. It never crossed the line to cheating. Well, at least in his mind. Since his retirement, Walter and Ethel visited with Ann and I across the U.S. We got together in Atlanta and Augusta, Phoenix, Charleston, San Diego, and several times in Florida. The last trip was 3 years ago, when Walter delegated the planning trip for a 2-week Caribbean cruise to Anne and I for his 70th birthday. It was a great trip, aided and abetted by the fantastic martini bar. I'll hoist one to him this evening. We had great plans for our next ventures, Hawaii, the Mediterranean, and a tour of the Highlands. Sadly, the cancer devil intervened soon after his return home from the cruise. We have all struggled this year to come to terms with Walter's diagnosis, alternating with anger, disbelief, and finally resignation to the inevitable ending on October 26th. The immediate family were all present when he passed away at home around 7 in the morning in the company of his doctor and friend, Dr. Paul Jackson. We are forever in Paul's debt for his guidance, strength, comfort, and compassion to Walter and the family throughout the night and at that fateful moment. On reflection, I take solace in the fact that Elizabeth and I shared our lives with a giant of a man as our brother, friend, and guardian over the past 68 years. A remarkable man and a remarkable life. We love that man. Walter Ferguson Smith, OBE, died October 26, 2021. May he forever rest in peace. Thank you.
What tender and poignant words from our brother. Thank you, Ian. For me, Walter Smith had quite a unique ability to hold in balance what he did and who he was. Yes, he was a great servant to club and country, but of late it's surely been the character of the man that people have talked about most, certainly in the community where he lived. How he treated people, even when they were intrusive, and they could be. His integrity, his honesty, his humility as a human being. That's what defined him and made him able to transcend all barriers of status, creed, and colour. I count it a privilege that Neil asked me to read what he had to say about Dad, and my reply was simple. I said to him, Neil, you nailed it. I knew you would, and you did. It used to be in church when you agreed with the preacher, you would shout out, Hallelujah, Amen. Well, inwardly, I hope at least every person in this cathedral was saying that when they listened to you, Neil. Mind you, I'm not too sure that they are allowed to shout that in the cathedral, are they, Mark? There we are. Hallelujah. The boss has said, so it's all right. Undoubtedly, it was who he was that evoked such contrasting emotions, sadness, pride, love, in fact, everything that's in the very best of human nature. And for me, one of the greatest things is that I don't think he ever really realized how much people loved him and respected him. And for me, that's really the mark of true greatness. Now I realize in this august company I enter dangerous territory. Because on the 6th of November 2012, Celtic celebrated their 125th birthday in the church where they were founded, and I was privileged to speak at that event. And during that evening, I actually mentioned Walter. And then the parish priest, Canon Thomas White, also spoke of Walter and Ethel with great affection because he too was brought up in Carmyle. And on the way back, Murdo McLeod, with whom I was travelling, phoned Walter, who, when he picked up the phone, immediately said, I know what you're going to tell me. And he rhymed off a whole list of Celtic luminaries, and he said, they didn't get a mention, but I got a mention three times. Lord Hawkey had texted him during the Mass. But, you know, Walter's comment caused Murdo and I to smile and reflect that Walter was touched that he should be mentioned on a special night at the home of his great footballing rivals. Gordon Smith, writing school, surely scored a hole-in-one when he described him as a great manager but an even better man. Sir Alec Ferguson talked of his great moral compass. Ally McCoist described him as the best husband, father, friend, everything you would want from a man. So you see, behind the football was a man who drew respect from all, irrespective of their tribal allegiances. Ian has talked of the early relationship between Walter and Ethel, and I'm always curious as to how husband and wife met, and I've heard them all, at least I thought I did. A local dance hall, a pub, through friends, and now increasingly on the web. But when I asked Ethel how they met, she phoned me. She said, in the pram. And I wondered if I'd heard it right. But his folks and her folks, as you've heard from Ian, were friends and neighbours, so the fathers went down to the bowling club for a wee drink, and the mothers were left with the wains. So this relationship has been going on for a long, long time. In fact, it first started when they swapped dummies in the pram. There must be very few who don't recognise the name of Walter Smith. Maybe as few as those who would not have recognised the author of this poem, which could well have been written about him. An honest man here lies at rest, the friend of man, the friend of truth, the friend of age, the guide of youth. Few hearts like his with virtue warmed, few heads with knowledge so informed. If there's another world, he lives in bliss. If there is none, he made the best of this. Rabbi could certainly have been talking about Walter Smith. Thank you for listening.
Ethel, Stephen, Neil and family, it's a privilege to say a few words about my friend Walter. Walter, only a few people who are instantly known by their first name. Elvis, Buddy, John, Paul, George, Ringo, and Walter. It was always Walter, because everyone saw him as a friend, as one of us, but some of us had the great joy of being his friend and getting to know him so well and sharing many memories along the way. I was sitting in a wine bar in Bristol and my mobile phone rang. And the voice at the end of the phone, which I think was Andy Cameron, said, "What can I do to help? What do you need done? What can I do?" And I said, "Well, you've kind of got me at a loss. I'm not very sure what you mean." And he said, "You've not seen the Glasgow Herald today." And I said, "No, I'm in Bristol." He said, "Well, you better phone James Mortimer because he's formed a testimonial committee for Walter and you're the chairman." And that was the start of my journey and friendship with Walter. A wonderful testimonial year, great dinners, great football matches. But perhaps the highlight was one Monday, sitting in the old manager's office at Ibrox, and the door chapped as it always did, and expected one of the nice ladies from Ibrox to bring in the tray with the pot of tea and the soup and the sandwiches. But actually, it was Paul Gascoigne who brought in the tray with the pot of tea and the soup and the sandwiches, because Walter had been having some words with him, and therefore I'd been kept waiting for 15 minutes. So it was his job to bring in the lunch that day. I've got lots of memories and lots of great stories of spending time with Walter. Some of them are quite bizarre, however. Before the World Cup in France in 1998, I was in, it sounds very grand, but I was in Monte Carlo with my board colleagues for a board meeting and a dinner. And on the Saturday, our big boss said, "Well, we're going to a very special restaurant in a very special hotel up a mountain in France." I went, "Fine, that sounds lovely." And off we went to France, crossed the border up a mountain and into this very nice hotel where we had a very nice meal. Getting towards the end of it, you get to the point where you say to some of your colleagues, "Let's go up to the bar and have a drink." So we walked up these very nice stairs to the bar. And as you got to the top of the stairs, you realised there was a shape sitting at the bar that you recognised. But before I could quite focus on that shape, from the left side of the room, I heard a lady's voice saying, "Alan," which was Ethel's voice. And we'd actually bumped into Walter and Ethel up a mountain in a restaurant in France. Walter gave me that famous look that's already been mentioned. And as we're in a place of worship, I can't use some of the words that he then said. but it was more along the lines of, what the bleep bleep are you doing in a bleep bleep restaurant up a bleep bleep mountain in France, and nobody will bleep bleep believe me. At the end of the evening, we gave Walt and Ethel a lift in our minibus back down to Monte Carlo, where we both lost our £20 each in about 20 seconds. Walter was a great friend also to our charity, Variety Scotland, the children's charity, and on behalf of all my colleagues there, I would also like to express their thanks for everything that he did for us, and he will always be in our hearts. There's a saying, don't meet your heroes, you will be disappointed. But I met my hero, and I was never disappointed. A better, kinder, more generous friend than you could ever hope to meet. In conclusion, we are here to celebrate your life and the measure of its worth and every single life you touched while you were here on earth. We wish to pay our last respects, that's why we are all here, to thank you for your friendship and all the memories we hold dear. It's been a privilege to have known you. We were family, not just friends. And we will carry you in spirit until we meet up again. Walter, thank you for the memories, and thank you for being my friend.
Everything has its time. For everything, there is a season, and a time for every matter under heaven. A time to be born, and a time to die. A time to plant, and a time to pluck up what is planted. A time to kill, and a time to heal. A time to break down, and a time to build up. A time to weep, and a time to laugh. A time to mourn, and a time to dance, a time to throw away stones, and a time to gather stones together, a time to embrace, and a time to refrain from embracing, a time to seek, and a time to lose, a time to keep, and a time to throw away, a time to tear, and a time to sow, a time to keep silence, and a time to speak, a time to love, and a time to hate, a time for war, and a time for peace.
Thank you. I haven't been as nervous since Nacho took that penalty, but we'll go on. Deeds done and glories won is the task. And Ian had already said, I've written down Walter Smith was a giant of a man, respected, revered by hundreds and thousands of Rangers fans all over the world. Walter was a great leader, and great leaders lead by example. They never lead by fear. And great leaders surround themselves with really strong characters. And Walter always surrounded himself with really strong characters. And he was our leader. And that journey really began properly, I suppose, the day we beat Aberdeen 2-0 and to win the league. And of course, the rest was history, but we're about to tell you something about that. In that game, he had a very depleted squad, lots of injuries. And in fact, Bomber took a jag, as the boys will tell you, knowing that it would probably rupture his Achilles. And Tom Cowan broke his leg and tried to play on. That was the kind of spirit that Walter instilled in the players. In fact, after the game, I spoke to Bomber and I said, you did well to last for 70 minutes. And he said, I did. I said, unfortunately, Tom had to go for a broken leg. And he says, aye, these youngins need to toughen up. That was Bomber. Well, what can you say? It was the start of the launch pad, the launch of Walter Smith's Blue and White Army. The league titles just kept coming, one after another after another. The Battle of Britain was won. A fantastic game, incredible achievement for us to beat the champions of England, Leeds United. We won on our own after losing an early goal, and then went down there against all odds. And Big Mark scored a phenomenal goal. And then we had one of the best moves ever, finished off by Coisty, sclaffing a header into the back post. Walter said he was aiming at the near post, but that wasn't the case. And we had the 5-1 Heart Cup final. Dukie scoring a hat trick and Loudrup getting the man of the match. And of course, we had Tannadice, Walter's original home. And then it was probably ironic that we had to do it there, but 9 in a row was clinched with a Loudrup header. Through all of this, this giant of a man remained the same Walter, very personable, superstars, cleaners, workers. It never mattered to Walter. He seemed to float through Ibrox and everybody was important. You always get the feeling of being important if you met Walter. It was a great joy to be in his company. He was a great storyteller, really good raconteur, and a great listener. I did have one unfortunate incident myself when I got the steer. We'd come back from Tyne Castle and we'd lost the match, and I was quite upset. And there was a bit of rant and raving going on in the car about the team that was picked and what we should have done. And Paul Burns grassed me up. I know it was Paul because he was only 2 years in the car, so I know that's how Walter found out. Anyway, a couple of weeks later, I'm walking through Ibrox and Walter comes past as he does. And, okay, John, and that sort of way, and then he turns and looks back and he said to me, aye, tell me you're a football manager now. That was me suitably warned. I never lived that one down. And to manage the players he managed, fantastic players, and it's impossible to name them all, but some of them are here today. Richard Goffey and Haitley and Loudrup, and easy players to manage, Walter said. And then, of course, we had McCoys, Durant, Gorham, Gascoigne, the crazy gang. And that tells you a lot about Walter as a manager, that he could cross over and manage all these different types of players and get their respect and get them to play. We trusted Walter completely as supporters, and he never let us down, never. Spells with Everton in Scotland, and then he came back because we needed him. And I don't think you should underestimate the risk that Walter took coming back. It must have been hard for Ethel and the family, because you live with that pressure for 7, 8, 9 years, then you escape, and then we haul him back in again. And that was an amazing second term, absolutely amazing. You look at it and you say 21 trophies in total, but during that we won the League Cup with 9 men, fantastic achievement. We won 3 league titles, again, amazing. And then, of course, there was Fiorentina, the penalties, and we were off to Manchester. So what can you say that hasn't already been said? A giant of a man, a fantastic character, a lovely friend, and a special person. So, Walter, thanks for the memories, and God bless. Thank you.
Good afternoon. Walter Smith had a trick when he met you. Didn't matter if he knew you. When he met you, he would always say, "How are you?" The phone would ring, and he'd go, "Andy, it's Walter. How are you?" And it put you right at your ease. I was 5 years old. My Uncle Joe took me to Ibrox to get vaccinated. That meant it wasn't a jag. This is your team. No other team counts. 60 years later, I'm doing a labour of love. I'm going up to the lounges to interview the players. Before the game, it would be a player who'd maybe been suspended or injured. And I'd take him through a few lounges, have a bit of fun with them, get a picture taken, autographs. The punters loved that, you know. Sometimes they ask the players for an autograph as well. And I come down in this day to do this, and I can't get into the office where I hang my jacket. And I hear the voice, "Andy, how are you?" "I'm fine, Walter." I said, "The office is locked. I can't hang my jacket up." He says, "Hang it in my office." And I went, "Aye, okay." The manager of Rangers Football Club, my hero, hang your coat in his office, the inner sanctum. I open the door and there they are, McCoys, Durant, McDowell, Big Jimmy Stewart, and I get the usual greeting, "What are you wanting?" I said, "The gaffer says I have to hang my coat." "Well, you can't. This is our workspace, beat it." And I went, "But the gaffer, get out, you're no welcome here, you know." And I was about to join the Burst Out Greeting Club when McCoy says, "Just hang your coat up now, the peg, Andy." He says, "Who are you interviewing?" I said, "Nacho Novo." Well, he says, "Good luck with that." He knew I knew what he meant, because Nacho and I had this problem with language. Neither of us were very good speaking English. I go up, do the interviews, and I come down. But this time, it's about 3 minutes to three before the game's just about to start. And I go into it, and the sweat's drenching. I'm trying to get for the kickoff. And I pick my jacket off the peg, and I said, no, something's not right. And the buttons were buttoned right up to the neck. The sleeves were tied in two knots. If you've ever seen Jimmy Stewart's hand, you'll know they weren't the wee knots. It took me ages to loosen it. I finally loosened it, the buttons. I put the coat on, and I went, that's not right. Put my hands in the pockets. There's knives and forks, custard creams, salted peanuts, unsalted peanuts, Totti crisps. And they knew I was on a balanced diet because there was a sausage roll in every pocket. Anyway, I go up and I watch the game. Needless to say, we won. And I come down, and after the game, I've got the same duty to perform with the man of the match. So I take him up, do the business there, and I come back down. But this time, Walter's got his guests in, like the opposing manager, and they're having a glass of red. And I walk in, and it's the usual, what are you doing? We're telling you, you're not here. Get out. And I just come back. I says, my pockets are empty, and I'm starving. Walter comes over right away, you know, everything all right? I said, sausage rolls are finished. And we explained to him what happened. And he just hit me in the shoulder, you know, the way he used to do, and he'd go like that. Ah, you're one of the boys now. That was Walter Smith. Put you at your ease all the time. May 2009, Rangers have won the league. We're playing the Scottish Cup final on the Saturday. Because they won the league, they're going for a double. And everybody's on the phone. You get us a ticket. Everybody's looking for tickets. My phone rings around about 1 o'clock on a Friday. Andy, it's Walter. How are you? I says, I'm fine. How are you? He says, Durante says you're looking for tickets. I said, aye. He says, I've got a couple for you. He says, come down to the hotel. I said, okay. When? The now? He says, no, about 4 o'clock. So I go down. It's Mar Hall, which is the old Erskine Hospital, which has got a great connection with Rangers Football Club. And I get down there, and I said to the girl, I think I have to pick a package up from Mr. Smith. Oh, she says, I have to phone him when you're here. Just have a seat. So I sat down, I've picked up something to read, and all of a sudden, a couple of minutes, and I hear, Andy, how are you? I said, oh, great, well, thanks a lot for us. He says, do you fancy a pot of tea? I went, aye, that'd be great. He says to the lassie, can you bring a pot of tea? We go out to the garden. There's nobody there. It's absolutely Walter and me, and garden furniture, and we sit down, pot of tea. He's got to pour the tea because I'm shaking. He's poured the tea, and from nowhere, he does the magician thing. He fancy one of these, and he brings out two Davidoff Robusto cigars. Now, neither of us are smokers, but we enjoyed a cigar. So we light up the cigars, and I'm sitting there. I wouldn't tell the Queen my auntie, you know what I mean? I'm just away with it, and we're chatting away. And then I scored an own goal. I said to him, is this us celebrating the double, gaffer? And I get the look. I thought I was Chick Young for 5 minutes. And he never raised his voice. He just says, you can't celebrate before you win it. You've got to earn the right to get to the final. You've got to cross the white line in the final and earn the right to win the trophy. He says, you can't celebrate before you win it. Just like that. And he took a puff of his cigar. He says, you're a Rugland boy, eh? I said, aye. Did you go and see the Glens? I said, aye. You used to climb out of the wall. Aye. He says, my dad was a great Cambuslang Lang Rangers supporter. And we started talking about junior football. The whole, you know, my own goal was forgotten. And then about maybe 5:30 or something, the cigars were finished. Right, I've got a team talk. He says, I'll see you tomorrow. I get into the car. And it dawned on me, I'll see you tomorrow. He knew he was going to win the double, but he wasn't going to celebrate before it. That was the kind of guy he was. We know he won 21 trophies. We know what he did in football. And that's in history. For us who were pals of his, he was just a great guy, an absolutely outstanding human being. Walter, thanks.
Good afternoon. On the wall of the trophy room of Ibrox Stadium, there's a framed reply to a letter from Mr. Jack Smith, written on behalf of his 12-year-old son, Walter, who was recovering from a leg injury from playing football. Mr. Smith inquired if his son could sit in the perimeter wall on the track running round the football pitch at Ibrox. The reply is from Scott Simon, then the Rangers manager, who explains with his customary courtesy why the request would have to be declined. The young Walter wasn't to know at that time that he himself would follow in Scott Simon's footsteps. Both Walter and Scott Simon are part of the tradition established by the gallant pioneers who founded Rangers Football Club almost 150 years ago. A tradition, and indeed a history, encapsulated in the words of Bill Struth, who set the standards of excellence demanded of Rangers managers and Rangers players. Standards still expected even today of those who wear the famous Royal Blue jersey. Walter himself lived to those standards. Here are Mr. Struth's words on what it is to be a Ranger. I've been lucky, lucky in those who are around me from the boardroom to the dressing room. In time of stress, their unstinted support, unbroken devotion to our club, and calmness in adversity ease the task of making Rangers FC the premier club in this country. To be a Ranger is to sense the sacred trust of upholding all that such a name means in this shrine of football. They must be true in their conception of what the Ibrox tradition seeks from them. No true Ranger has ever failed in the tradition set them. Our very success, gained, you will agree, by skill, will draw more people than ever to see it. And that will benefit more clubs, many more clubs than Rangers. Let the others come after us. We welcome the chase. It's healthy for us. We will never hide from it. Never fear. Inevitably, we shall have our years of failure. And when they arrive, we must reveal tolerance and sanity. No matter the days of anxiety that come our way, we shall emerge stronger because of the trials to be overcome. That has been the philosophy of the Rangers since the days of the gallant pioneers. A philosophy that was steadfastly upheld by Walter Smith, a man who always delivered the highest of standards. Thank you.
All in there. Walter was not always a giant. We go back to 72, the birthplace of some of the greatest managers and coaches, the Largs. Walter was going through his badges. I was in a refresher course. Craig Brown says to me, "Why don't you have a look at this lad? What do you think?" Imagination, control of the sessions. He was a certainty to Jamaica. And he was playing for Dundee United. So some years later, I got an opportunity to manage Aberdeen. I approached Walter to be my assistant. He was interested. He says, "You'll need to speak to the wee man, wee Jim." So I phoned Jim McLean. Well, you know what it's like. The phone's over here. "I've got him on a 4-year contract, 4 options, 4 years. You'll never get him. We'll take you every court in the land." I didn't know there was that many courts. It got messy. I gave in. Phoned Walter. I says, "It's not going to work. The wee man's going mad." So he had a great career. And really, Jim McLean needed Walter. Walter was fantastic for him because he was different. He was a different person from Walter. And at that time, Aberdeen and Dundee United were, without question, as strong as Rangers and Celtic. And the rivalry between the two clubs was intense. You know, it was incredible. But off the pitch, we were great. We played 5-a-sides against each other on Friday nights. They would come up to Aberdeen, we'd come down to Dundee. And those games were worse than the actual rivalry. So his time at Rangers under Graham Souness
was a fantastic period. Our lives changed, actually, in 1986. I was the manager of Scotland after Jolstein died. I appointed Walter as my assistant. We're going to Mexico. I knew that Walter was going to Ibrox under Graham. A few months later, I was with Manchester United. Our world changed. And they had appeared with Graham. And Graham has acknowledged that many times. Without Walter, it would never have been the same, which is true. Graham was started his career at Rangers as a manager and did a fantastic job, changed the whole landscape of Scottish football. And then he decides to go to Liverpool. Now, at that time, I thought, I wonder, will they give it to Walter, the job? And my take was, there's no one better at understanding Rangers Football Club. Expectation. He grew up with granddad, grew up at Copeland Road to see Rangers. He knew what Rangers meant, that expectation. Now, I was only there for 2.5 years, but believe me, I carried that expectation throughout my life. What it really means to be a big club and win. And that's what Walter gave to Rangers. He knew Rangers. And it was a great appointment. It was a right appointment. Unfortunately for me, he got and stole my bloody assistant manager. I got the phone call, we're in the League Cup final, and I said to Walter, I'll get you a couple of tickets. And the phone going, I'm saying, oh, that's the one for the tickets. That dulcet tone was there. He says, I've offered Archie the job. I says, Jesus Christ, Walter. I'm sorry. I think my loudest swear word in the circumstances. So I says, when did this happen? He says, well, I spoke to Archie the other day. Now, I could have been angry with Walter, but he did the right thing. If I would become a manager, I would think that Archie knocked right away. Because what he was bringing was a tornado. A guy who worked his socks off all his life. A farmer's son. And I was angry with United because they wouldn't match Rangers' salary. So he deserved to go. He said he deserved to take the opportunity. I know I was going to miss him. But in a way, I was pleased that he wanted the challenge of going to Rangers and join Walter and Archie. What a twosome. And they did fantastic. You know, that I couldn't be angry. The only problem I had at the time was we had the European Cup final 2 weeks from then against Barcelona and Rotterdam. And going into without Archie is a loss. There's no question about that. I depended on the staff at the time, Eric Harrison and Brian Whitehouse. And they had a great period at Rangers and then went to Everton. And there was a connection there in a little way, although Manchester and Liverpool, you know, doesn't really connect too well. In 2004, I lost Carlos Queiroz to Real Madrid. And he was only there about 2 months, and he phoned me and says, I'm leaving. I can't have it. I'm not enjoying it. I said, you don't resign from Real Madrid, son. You stay. End of season, I'll bring you back. So I went through 6 months through an assistant. But coming the second half of the season, I'm saying to myself, I need someone. And Walter wasn't working at the time. So I drove up to Glasgow, met Walter, and I says, when do you do me a favour? Come to me, you know, be my assistant to the end of the season. I explained the situation with Carlos Queiroz. He says, yeah, absolutely. Well, that was fantastic. It was brilliant, honestly. That he refereed the games. And with this young boy, Ronaldo, who came with all the tricks in the world, and he wanted to beat everybody in the world, and the players were hammering him. They turned like, Phil, play on! And that was it. Play on. And he walks over to me and says, "Boss, do they not have fouls in Scotland?" I said, "No, no." I got to the stage, I was actually walking away from Walter as he was making these decisions, but play on. And he learned, by the way. He learned how to pass the ball. And he can thank Walter for that, without question. But I've actually missed a point here that's a really important point, and it was the worst decision I ever made in my life. In Mexico, Walter was my assistant, and we actually did well. We're in a group of death, Germany, Denmark, Uruguay in the last game. All we needed to do was beat Uruguay. And I always had a thing about my life that I would make a decision before I went to bed. I would make a decision and never change. I always felt, get a sweep. So I made my mind up to leave Grahamstown out. Now, you know, one of the great assets that Walter had was a fantastic asset, was to listen, you know? So I says to Walter, "I'm going to leave Graham out." He said, "Oh," he says, "you can't leave him out." He says, "Christ, he's a captain." I says, "Lost 6 kilos in the last game. It's going to be warm against Uruguay. It's going to be bloody roasting hot." He says, "Well, it's a big decision." So the next morning, I had to chat again before I went to speak to Graham. He says, "And always remember his words, never forget it. He'll never let you down in a big game." I says, "Bloody hell." So I was stubborn, had it in my mind. I made my mind up. I went to Graham and explained to him. He says, "I'll have to make decisions like myself." I accepted it. And the biggest mistake I made was, says, "Do you want to be a sub?" He says, "No, I think I'll leave it." No. So Batista gets sent off in a minute. A terrible striking and got a tackle on the ground striking. The composure had gone. Where was Graham? Sitting in the stand. That was the biggest mistake. Because at that point, they needed someone just to calm them down, show them the way forward, and everything would have been all right. I'm sure of that. I think we'd have won. Lost 1-0. Sorry, 3-0-0. We're out. So it was a tragedy for us because we had a good set with a great staff, Archie, Craig Brown, Andy Roxburgh, and Walter and I. And we had a good set of players, and we're really unlucky not to do better. So the world rolls on. Walter is at Everton. Then he goes back to Rangers after his spell with Scotland, and his staff is Ali McCoy's assistant manager of Scotland, and Tommy Burns. He goes back to Scotland, to Rangers. He takes Ali with him. Durant's in the staff, and I says, "That's a challenge." "How is he going to keep the two out of the district bar?" So I was interested in how he was going to manage us, because they were a pair, weren't they? I hadn't been in a Rangers Celtic game for years. So I got to Ibrox's Rangers Celtic game, the 1-0. And I go down to the coach's room. You wouldn't believe this, but it's true. Here's Durante sitting in Walter's desk with his feet in the desk. And Coyce is sitting beside him. By the way, Coyce was good. He got me a chair to sit beside him. That was very nice of him. And I look over at the locker rooms, the cheap seats, and there's Walter and Graham Souness and all the staff sitting there. And Durant is giving it how they win the game and all the rest of it. And I look over at Walter and he's that wee smile. Nods towards the two of them, right? "You're in for a pantomime." And I say to myself, how does that work? Durant and McCoy's and Walter Smith. You know the answer? Personality. He used their personality in that dressing room. A fantastic appointment. It was absolutely brilliant. And it's something that you say to yourself, well, he took Archie Knox in a different way He needed his buddy. He needed someone that could work his socks off. And then years later, he takes McCoist and Durant. Completely different personality, which is really important. And that was a different Rangers from where when he was at Ibrox the first time with Graham. And I thought that was real management. I thought it was fantastic. And of course, you know, that it was his last spell with Rangers. He did some work with the league managers. The managers all loved him, Klopp and Guardiola. They loved his company. And he did quite an important job in actually sent him, particularly so many foreign managers in England now, how do you think the league managers are doing for you? And you would get that feedback for the league managers. And, you know, an incredible, as I say, I was looking for the word till Ian mentioned it, giant. I was looking for a word that could encapsulate this man, and it's definitely giant. So what does he leave? And all these players that have come here today, as any of them thinking about becoming a manager, think seriously. Unless you've got qualities that Walter Smith had, forget about it. It's a really difficult industry in which Walter performed for a long, long time. Well done, Noah.
Good afternoon, everyone. Kind of bizarre, really, isn't it? It's just brilliant to see everybody. So many faces, the Everton lads coming up, the Dundee United boys coming in there, brilliant. Hamish, Holtie, Morris Malpas, all the lads. It's just a shame. The biggest shame is the one man that would have loved to have been here to see everybody's Walter. He would have loved it. He loved company. Absolutely loved company. Listen to Sir Alex there. Imagine being able to drop Graham Souness. Would that not be brilliant? Eh? And I've given my teeth for that, Gaffer, I'll tell you right now. Anyway, we're here clearly to talk about Walter, the man, his football career, and indeed the person. His football career, it will be very brief, because frankly it was bang average, Walter's football career, for want of a better description. Played at United, Dumbarton. In fact, one of the stories, one of the great stories, I think it was his 65th birthday. And we thought, what are we going to get Walter for his birthday? And Kenny and Geranti and myself come up with an idea. Believe it or not, during his playing career, he scored semi-final, 1976 Scottish Cup semi-final. Walter scored at Hampden. So I managed to get a copy of this photograph. Beautiful picture. Walter flying through the air. Beautiful. Looks as though he'd been fired out a cannon, to be quite frank with you. Getting on there on the end of this cross, putting Hearts 1 up. Brilliant goal. Spot on. He was playing centre back for Dumbarton that day. And it was indeed the opening goal for Hearts, which they eventually won 3-0, but he did take it in the spirit it was clearly meant. But he was fantastic. He played for United, as I say, Dallas Tornado, Dumbarton, and then Dundee United again. But clearly, it was as a coach and as a manager that we all knew Walter better, and that's where he had great, if not phenomenal, success. Scotland under-18s was the first time I had the opportunity to meet him. And a trip to Monaco, my roommate, believe it or not, was Davy Moyes. Davy Moyes was my roommate. And we first came across Walter, our past met, obviously under-21s as well, coached at United, wonderful period. And that, as Sir Alex was saying, a wonderful team with Dundee United, tremendous. And then he assisted Sir Alex with Scotland in 86 and indeed 2004. Managed Rangers, Everton, Scotland and Rangers again. He was a director at Rangers and a chairman at Rangers for a period. Excuse me, won 21 trophies, phenomenal. Absolutely fantastic. Great leader of men. Wonderful leader of men. But as I said last week at the funeral, his real strength and where he was happiest No doubt about it. Where Walter was happiest was in the peloton. I make no apologies for saying it again. He loved being in the peloton. He loved his family and his friends and his mates and his golf buddies. He loved being in there. That's where he was at his happiest. Having a glass of wine, a game of golf, a meal with Ethel, in that peloton. But where he was great, where he was at his best, was when he knew the time to come out the peloton. To come out the peloton and lead. Lead men. That was his main strength for me. He was happy in there. He was comfortable in there. But he knew, I need to step out of this peloton. I need to lead. That's what I've got to do. And I was saying, last week, I was in the butcher shop in Kilmacombe. A place, as you can see, I go to quite regularly. And there was an old lady and an old gentleman came up to me. And the lady said to me, "Listen, son, we're really, really sorry for your loss. Really sorry for your loss. He was a very, very decent man, Walter." And I thought about it. And I thought, yeah, he was. He certainly was. But I looked up what decency was. And it was the behaviour that conforms to accepted standard of morality and indeed respectability. And he had that in bundles, Walter. And the word just was perfect for him. He had it in absolute bundles. But he had a great, as Sir Alex said, he had a great group of people around him. He could gauge people. He judged people. He was magic. And a couple of stories. Because the funeral was last week, and this is a celebration of Walter's life. And we want to put a smile on one or two faces. I was Walter's assistant with Scotland, with Tommy Burns. Brilliant. And I was his assistant at Rangers. And people say, "How was it? What was your biggest job?" And I'm deadly serious. My biggest job was on the Friday before the game. He had to have an Empire biscuit for the meeting at 2 o'clock. He had to have an Empire biscuit. He loved an Empire biscuit. So there was one Friday. I'm downstairs and he said to me, "I'm running late." He says, "The meeting's at 2:15. I went, "Nay, bother, gaffer, I'll tell the boys." So I went upstairs, sat down, tea's all there, cakes are there, gaffer's Empire biscuits there. I said to wee Durante, I said, "Phone me at 2:10. He went, "Why?" I said, "Just phone me at 2:10 and don't say anything." Fine. So I'm sitting in the office, my phone goes at 2:10. I went, "Hello? All right, gaffer. Yep. No problem at all. Absolutely. All right, we'll see you then. Bye." Puts the phone down. Just get back to the office. Big Jimmy Stewart says, what is that? What's going on there?" I said, "It's a gaffer." I said, "His son's come up." I said, "He's not going to make the meeting." I said, "Unfortunately, he's had to get into Glasgow." He says, "I'll just see you at the ground tomorrow." I said, "No bother." So within, must have been 30 seconds. I've got Big Jimmy 30 seconds. The big hand goes in. Bang. The Empire biscuit. So he puts it to his mouth. Brilliant. I can just see the whole thing unfold in slow motion. The tap teeth have just hit the icing. The bottom set of the nashers have just hit the biscuit bit. The door opens. It's the gaffer. Me, your auntie and coach have jumped up. "Gaffer, what about the big you need? Your Empire biscuit." Well, I can safely tell you, I don't think the big one has since ate an Empire biscuit. There was another time, honestly, we're playing Falkirk and Falkirk, and I'm on the bench. It wasn't just Graham that put me on the bench. Walter put me on the bench as well. And we're 1-2, and my face is tripping me. You've no idea. I'm no playing. I'm in the huff. Toys at the pram. Everything. Anyway, puts me on for the last 10 minutes and I missed 2 or 3 chances, but we win 2-0. So my face is tripping me. We get back into the dressing room. Boys are knocked about. I'm sitting there, petted lip, feeling sorry for myself. Archie says, "Well done, lads. Good result today. Comfortable. Boys that played," he says, "have a day off tomorrow." He says, "The boys that never played, we'll see you tomorrow morning for training." I says, you'll not see me tomorrow morning for training. He says, no, no, no. He said, the boys that play every day off, he said, the substitutes, you win tomorrow morning for... Nah, I'm not coming in. You'll not see me tomorrow morning. He says, you win tomorrow morning. I says, Archie, I'll no be in tomorrow morning. I says, and there it is there. I point at my chin. I says, you want to have a crack at it? I have a crack at it. So thankfully, there's four of the boys holding Archie back, right? Because I wasn't winning that one for sure. Four of the boys hanging them back. I get into the... It's all kicking off in the dressing room. I get in for my shower. So I'm sitting there. Now, the gaffer's been out doing the press. Walter's been out doing the press. He obviously comes back into the dressing room. He's heard of it all kicking off in the dressing room. So he walks into the shower. He says, what's the matter with you? I said, nah, just no happy. I said, he's trapped. And I said, I scored, I never scored. He went, aye. You all right? I went, I'm all right. He says, you know what? I says, what? He says, you're in tomorrow morning. And I'll never forget it. I was in tomorrow morning. And I went in for training on Sunday. And Archie Knox had put above the dressing room, Rangers Football Club would like to take this opportunity and welcoming Coisty to training on Sunday morning. Absolutely priceless. Priceless. What else do we say about Walter? I told you, I wrote down some words about Walter. What was he? He was loyal. He was caring. He was considerate. He was honest. He was hardworking. He was unbelievably friendly. He really was friendly. He just put you at ease. As Andy said, I've never met Andy. He put you at ease. And an absolutely wicked, wicked sense of humour. He really had a wicked sense of humour. He used to tell people that Big Goffey, you love this one, Big Goffey was one of the first people in Scotland to get a book contract for Adidas. He told everybody, Adidas gave him 20 grand not to wear their boots. A lot of truth in it. But I always remember, one of my abiding memories of being with Walter was the penalty shootout in Florence. Honestly, 2-0 each games, we defended like you've got absolutely no idea. It was unbelievable. We should have been actually in the High Court the following morning for theft, winning that game in penalties. But I'll never forget it. Wee Nacho has gone up to take the winning penalty, which turned out to be the winning penalty, thankfully. And Walter genuinely turned to me and said, what's the score? He didn't know the score of the penalties. And I said to him, Gaff, I said, if this penalty hits the back of the net, you'll find out what the score was. Right? And of course, we scored it. And it was probably, in all honesty, it might be the most emotional I've ever seen Walter after that game. It was incredible. Because he knew that team, to get to that final, was one of the managerial performances ever in Scottish football. It was absolutely remarkable. Remarkable it was. Tremendous. I want to, if I may, we spoke about what's a legacy. What's Walter's legacy? Again, somebody's legacy is ultimately the story of a person's life, and it will reflect the individual's legacy. And we know Walter's got 21 trophies. We know Walter's done this, that, and the next thing. But I think it was Ian that said, there's no doubt about it. That's Walter's legacy. You guys are Walter's legacy. He loved you. He loved us all. He was a father figure to us all. But you are his legacy. Ethel, Neil, Stephen, immediate family, those wonderful, wonderful grandkids. God, he loved you. He absolutely loved you, like you've no idea. And I said a wee saying last week, and I'll say it again for you guys, if I may. There's a wonderful lady called Maya Angelou, and she was an American poet, writer, and human and civil rights activist along the times of Malcolm X and Martin Luther King. And she said, people may forget what you said. People may indeed forget what you did. But people will never forget how you made them feel. And I don't think I will ever forget what Walter did. And I don't think I'll ever forget what Walter said. But I can guarantee you, I will never, ever, ever forget how that man made us all feel. Walter, we love you to bits. Thank you very much for the memories.
In this service, we've shared a journey together through Walter's life. Some were able to be part of that journey in accompanying Walter at different stages. Others shared that journey from a more distant perspective. So we're here towards the end of a service that's an act of thanksgiving for the place that Walter has in our lives. As I begin the prayer, I would ask that if you're not religious, that you reflect on the place of Walter in your own life and how he was part of your life. But all of us should think too on those whom we love and what they bring to our life and what we bring to theirs. If you're religious, please use this prayer in a similar way in the context of your own faith, your own understanding, and your own hopes and aspirations. Let us pray. Loving God, our Heavenly Father, you created each one of us in your own image. Everyone, anyone. We give thanks today for the life of Walter Smith in our lives. Through his own life, his work, in the ways in which he's been an inspiration to each and every one of us here today. And we reflect on the beginnings of Walter's life, how he was nurtured in the family home Betty and Jack worked to build for him, Ian and Liz. And from that family home in Carmyle, Walter went out into the world to build his own life with his soulmate Ethel, both together guided by a strong sense of values that they shared about what is really important in life. Values which can be seen today in the lives of Neil with Karen, Stephen with Carrie, and taken even further forward to new generations through Jessica, Adam, Jack, Kian, Zach, Tom, and Matthew. These are the ones who loved Walter dearest, the ones who missed him deepest, as husband, father, grandfather, and brother. We reach out in compassion and love towards them, as we are reminded that Walter's life was much greater than the trophies he won or the positions of leadership he held. Walter's life, for which we give thanks, Walter's achievements, in which we rejoice in and recognise, began and flourished from love of his family and Walter's own love and respect for his fellow human beings. His is a life worthy of our thanks. And as a football and a civic community, we honour a man known for his own sense of humility, who strove for excellence in what he did to inspire and develop young football players, taking them not into players, but also into citizens, to lead his country, to achieve more than what was thought possible. And for those of us who are Rangers supporters, who see our great club as our family, we honour one of our own who stood for the very best values and traditions of our great club, because this is who we are. In honouring and being thankful for Walter's life, we reach out, as he would, in love and compassion to Gary Stevens with Angela and Oliver as they grieve the loss of Jack, their son, their brother. Loving God, who cares for each one of us, you know the pain, the hurt of grieving for your own son. So let Gary, Angela and Oliver be comforted by the presence of our love, our compassion, from this ancient cathedral. May the Everton community know that they too are in our thoughts and prayers. And thus, when we go from this ancient cathedral, a place standing on sacred ground where the message of your love for humanity has been proclaimed for more than 1,500 years, let us be inspired by Walter's life and see it as part of that same message passed from generation to generation. And that though Walter is now no longer physically present with us, in being at rest in your kingdom, we are assured he is reunited with those from his life who have gone before him. For us, Walter's inspiration, his influence and the values he believed in continue in and through our lives. Let then our life journey now go forward, inspired, encouraged by what we have heard of Walter's life and his continuing story alongside our story. In Walter's life journey, may we be able to see today not as the end, but a continuation of the story of a man we recognise, respect, and love as a good man. This our prayer we make in the name of your own dear Son, Jesus Christ our Lord, to whom with the Father and the Holy Spirit be glory and praise, now and forever. Amen. In the family home that Walter was brought up in, it was very much a Christian home, and Walter and Ian were encouraged to join the Boys' Brigade, and there they developed into the young men and the men that they became. So we're going to conclude this service, this journey through Walter's life, this service of thanksgiving, with one of the great hymns of the Christian faith, a hymn that's very much the Boys' Brigade hymn, "Will Your Anchor Hold in the Storms of Life?"
And so may you now go from here, knowing that you do not go alone, but in the companionship and kinship of those who have stood by your side and will in the days to come. Know you have done a good thing in giving thanks for a good man. And may the blessing of Almighty God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon you, those whom you love, and those whom you struggle to love, from this day forward and forevermore.
I'm Mark. Nice to see you. I'm sorry I never saw you.